Hi, this is Annie Dance. Please subscribe to AnnieDance.substack.com, my Cops in Congress newsletter. I'm an independent investigative journalist working to shine a light on police and policy issues in Western North Carolina and beyond. You simply type your email into the box and click subscribe, and you can select if you'd like to become a paid subscriber, which will get you even greater access to many exclusives, scoops, and other highlights of my work, including my past archives and all of my stories. I greatly appreciate your help as I continue this important work. If you are already subscribing, thank you, and you may have already seen my story published today, Monday, June 24th, 2024, Bishop and Jackson clash in heated NC Attorney General debate. If you haven't already subscribed, don't worry, you can, and you can see that story too. The candidates highlighted contrasting views on law enforcement, social media, election integrity, and the role of the state's top cop. And in my story, there's two pictures next to each other, Jeff Jackson on the left and Dan Bishop on the right, and they're both leaving Congress to run for North Carolina Attorney General in the 2024 election. In a high-stakes debate on Friday, Republican Congressman Dan Bishop and Democratic Congressman Jeff Jackson clashed in Charlotte over their competing visions for North Carolina's Attorney General role. The discussion, organized by the North Carolina Bar Association and broadcasted by Spectrum News, highlighted the stark differences between the candidates and how the Attorney General should function and the broader political issues at play. The candidates debated the responsibilities of the Attorney General, a position Democrats have held for 8 years with Josh Stein, now a gubernatorial candidate. Bishop criticized Stein for not consistently defending the state's laws in court and argued that Jackson would similarly oppose the Republican-led legislature if elected. Quote, Jeff has pledged to oppose the legislature on policies he disagrees with, end quote, Bishop said, emphasizing his belief that the Attorney General should defend all state laws regardless of personal stance. He cited the example of New York Attorney General Letitia James criticizing her for targeting former President Donald Trump, which he argued was abusing the office's power. Jackson retorted by highlighting Bishop's controversial actions following the 2020 presidential election, where Bishop voted against certifying President Joe Biden's victory. Quote, that big speech was given by someone who voted against certifying the last election, end quote, Jackson said, accusing Bishop of pandering to extremists. Bishop defended his stance, explaining that his doubts about the election's legitimacy were tied to pre-election lawsuits altering voting procedures. He accused Jackson of attacking him for his stance due to the Capitol riots on January 6, 2021. Both candidates' records in Congress came under scrutiny. Bishop criticized Jackson for his votes on criminal justice issues, particularly a bill regarding Washington, D.C.'s criminal code. Jackson, in turn, attacked Bishop's social media rhetoric and his calls for drastic measures against federal agencies like the FBI. In 2022, Bishop tweeted, quote, Republicans must smash the FBI into a million pieces, unquote. And in my story, I have a screenshot of that tweet. Jackson, a former Gaston County prosecutor and National Guard major with the JAG Corps, positioned himself as a centrist, emphasizing his bipartisan efforts in Congress. He pledged to aggressively tackle money laundering and fentanyl distribution if elected Attorney General, while also establishing a cold case unit. He accused Bishop of being excessively partisan and not truly committed to law and order. Jackson has represented the 14th congressional district since 2023. It was redrawn for the 2024 election. During a question on maintaining and attracting more people to law enforcement, Bishop said Jackson voted against every pay increase for Highway Patrol, NCSHP, State Bureau of Investigation, SBI, Alcohol Law Enforcement, ALE, and corrections officers while he was a state senator. But the problem, Bishop said, goes beyond pay. Police across the country need the support of both political parties. Jackson defended his vote against law enforcement pay raises because they were in the annual state budget, which he believes underfunded public education. Bishop, who has represented the 8th congressional district since 2019, argued that Jackson's legislative record showed a pattern of being soft on crime. He highlighted Jackson's opposition to various Republican-led bills, including on immigration and law enforcement cooperation with U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement, also known as ICE. On the topic of TikTok, Jackson defended his vote for a potential ban despite having a significant following on the platform, emphasizing the need to address national security concerns. Bishop, who voted against the ban, argued it infringed on free speech, but criticized Jackson for his seemingly contradictory stance. The debate underscored the national implications of the state race, with both candidates drawing on their differing responses to the 2020 presidential election and their broader political philosophies. As the race for North Carolina's attorney general continues, voters are left to weigh these contrasting visions for the state's top law enforcement position. Early voting begins on October 17th. Election day is November 5th, and you may read more about the upcoming election on the state website, ncsbe.gov. I read that from annie.substack.com/p/nc-attorney-general-bishop-n-jackson-debate. You may read it there, or I'm also doing this audibly if you want to listen and or watch this on my YouTube page. And if you are reading the article, thank you. This article is free to read due to generous support from founding member subscribers. Please support my future work. There's a link to six reasons to support my independent journalism in case you missed it. Again, you simply just type your email in and hit subscribe, and then you will get access to Cops in Congress. You may also click on the various links to learn more about this newsletter and my background. You can, of course, follow me on X, formerly Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, Instagram, TikTok, and YouTube. I primarily use Facebook the most at Annie M. Dance and X at Annie M. Dance, but I'm also on those other platforms as well. Please send tips and public documents for future stories, copsincongress@gmail.com. It doesn't really apply to this story, but just again to note, this is a standard footer in all of my stories. All those mentioned are presumed innocent until proven guilty. Again, free subscribers upgrade to paid to leave a comment and don't miss out on exclusive content. Thank you for reading and listening to Cops in Congress by Annie Dance. This post is public, so you can share that. And now I am going to play the entirety of the debate word for word as a way to archive it, because you never know what can happen to things these days, right? So please bear with me for just a moment while I play that from Spectrum News.
Hello and welcome to this Spectrum News One special decision 2024 North Carolina Attorney General Forum. I'm Tim Boyne, coming to you from the Charlotte Convention Center, where I moderated the forum as part of the Bar Association's annual event. This race features two candidates with very different views on the future of North Carolina, and it's being watched all across the country. So let's get right to it. Gentlemen, it's good to see you both. Thank you so much for being here for this Attorney General Forum. Each candidate's going to get a two-minute opening statement and two-minute closing statement. They also have 2 minutes for each question. The Bar Association traditionally goes in alphabetical order, so we'll start that way, then alternate who gets to answer each question first. We will begin with Congressman Bishop, a two-minute opening.
Thank you, Tim. Thank you to the Bar Association. Thank you to Spectrum for facilitating this event. It's pretty simple. In the race for Attorney General of North Carolina this year, I am the law and order candidate. My top priority is restoring law and order in North Carolina, period. You should ask yourself, over the last several years, last 4 years or so, do you feel safer in your community in North Carolina? Do you believe your family, your children are safer than they were before that time period? Do you believe that our nation's borders are secure? Or do you look at events like Chechens in conflict with a U.S. Army Special Operations Colonel in Carthage, North Carolina, the shootout and standoff with police by an Eritrean in Gates County, North Carolina, the arrest of a Honduran for a murder committed in Mecklenburg County, the arrest of a El Salvadoran for because he's wanted by Interpol for raping a 13-year-old. Does does that indicate something is amiss? Does it indicate something is amiss that the chief of police of Charlotte-Mecklenburg Police repeatedly warns that juveniles are out of control? If the answer is no, if you're not certain that you're safer, you got to ask why that is. And the answer is Democrats, just like Jeff Jackson. Defunding police was the worst policy idea in the history of the United States. And Jeff marched with protesters chanting defund the police. He has been consistently over his legislative record, soft on crime and antagonistic toward police. That's going to change. That's going to change in the North Carolina Attorney General's office because we need to have reverence for the law. And the role of the Attorney General is to be the state's lawyer, to enforce the law according to its terms.
Congressman Jackson, 2 minutes. Good morning. Good to see you. Dan, glad you're here. I'm Jeff Jackson. I'm running for Attorney General. 10 years ago, I was a prosecutor in Gaston County, just next door. Had worked there for several years, done a lot of serious cases, sex offense cases, domestic abuse, homicide. Was going to be a career prosecutor, had gone to law school to become a prosecutor. And then at the end of court one day, this defense attorney came up and said, Jeff, did you hear the news? I said, no, what happened? He said, the mayor of Charlotte was just arrested by the FBI for taking bribes from undercover FBI agents. And I said, that's amazing. And then I just went on about my day. I didn't think it was going to have anything to do with me. But the mayor stepped down the next day. We needed a new mayor. My state senator was picked to become the new mayor of Charlotte. And then pretty much out of the blue, I was picked to replace my state senator. I was 31 years old. I had never run for office. I didn't know anyone who had ever run for office. My last time to the General Assembly had been on the third grade field trip. And I found myself in the state Senate. That began my career in political service. But my career in military service had begun earlier. I enlisted after the attacks of September 11th. I served with Army Special Operations in Afghanistan, and I continue to serve. I am now a major in the National Guard. I'm running for Attorney General because Attorney General is about standing up for people. As a prosecutor, a soldier, and a legislator, that is who I am, and that is what I have done. I am the only person on this stage who has ever prosecuted a single case. The only person who has ever worked with law enforcement. And we're going to win this race. Thank you.
All right. First question. What do you see as the key role for Attorney General in North Carolina? And what would you focus on tackling? And would you make any changes to the Department of Justice? 2 minutes to you first, Congressman Bishop.
Thank you, Tim. And I've already gotten at it. But the key role of the Attorney General of North Carolina is to enforce the law. Not laws that you like only, and disregard laws that you don't like, not to serve as a policy counterweight to an elected legislature. That is an attack on our constitutional form of government. The responsibility of the Attorney General, it is a complex department, by the way, but the responsibility of the Attorney General at all points is to enforce the law. That means working closely with district attorneys and with frontline law enforcement all across the state to see to it that they are backed up, that they are advocated for, that their work is coordinated and supported before the legislature. It also means that when it comes to questions about policy, it is not for the Attorney General to do what he wants to do. When you're as the Attorney General of North Carolina, you are the state's lawyer. And lawyers in this room will recognize the responsibility. That is, you advocate for your client's position, that is the state of North Carolina through its elected representatives and laws that they pass, if there is any good faith, non-frivolous argument for the support of their position. That is to say, there are occasions when an attorney general might properly take a departure, refuse to defend the law that has been passed by the General Assembly, but it would have to be only in the circumstances that beyond all doubt, it is not constitutional. But what we've seen in the past two attorneys general in North Carolina and what Jeff has vowed to do before political audiences across North Carolina is to oppose the legislature on policy issues with which He disagrees with the elected legislature. Well, the elected legislature and the law is that's the way the law is made. And if we do that, that is the end of law. The ultimate expression of that approach to the office is Letitia James, the Attorney General of New York, who vowed in her campaign to use every power at her disposal to pursue and destroy one particularly despised political enemy. That is the very end of law in this nation if that is permitted to continue. That is wrong.
Congressman Jackson? Speaking of the end of law in this nation, all of that big speech was just given to you by someone who voted against certifying the last election. He was a lawyer. He knew better. He decided to pander to the people who stormed the Capitol. So let's start there. Here's what we need to do to keep people safe. And what I would do as Attorney General. First, fentanyl. We're losing 9 people a day in our state to the fentanyl epidemic. We need to do a better job of identifying and breaking apart the distribution cells that exist within our state. Last week, the General Assembly passed an anti-money laundering law. We didn't have one as a state. It goes into effect this December. The first thing I'm going to do is aggressively use that new tool to identify and break apart the distribution cells that exist within our state. I'm also going to ask the fentanyl. I'm also going to ask the General Assembly for funds for a fentanyl control unit so we can do that as aggressively as possible. Scammers. Scammers are about to get their hands on artificial intelligence. AI-enabled scammers is going to be a new type of threat that the Attorney General needs to aggressively meet. We're going to need new tools from the General Assembly to do that. In Congress, we've had people come and tell us that they got a phone call from their grandson saying, I was just in a car accident and I need you to wire me money. Grandpa says, of course. Hangs up and then calls back, realizing he needs more information. The grandson says, what are you talking about? I never called you. That voice replication technology is going to be the new threat that, in particular, senior citizens in our state are going to face. I'm going to ask our General Assembly for new tools with which to deal with that. Lastly, we need a cold case unit at the General Assembly, or rather at the Attorney General's office. The General Assembly did a very good thing a few years ago. They put a few million dollars aside to help us clear the rape kit backlog in this state. That helped us get justice for victims, but it also helped us identify perpetrators who were at large. We should take the same idea with the same approach, have a standing cold case unit at the Attorney General's office to help identify perpetrators who were still at large. Now I ask you, who was talking culture war and who was talking public safety?
All right, for our next question, there has been much discussion about trust in the justice system, broadly speaking. Talk of the death of the justice system, lawfare, weaponization. What role does the state attorney general play in restoring that faith in the justice system if it is no longer there? We'll start with you, Congressman Jackson.
This is a great question. It's one of the most important, and it's going to be a big difference between myself and my opponent. I believe the only way to earn trust, particularly in a law enforcement job, and that's what this is to treat it in a fundamentally nonpartisan way. I score among the top 5% most bipartisan members of Congress. My opponent scores in the bottom 5%. He is in the 5% most extreme members of Congress. And y'all, for this Congress, that's really saying something. You got to try to get there. His first two endorsements, Matt Gaetz and Warren Boebert, two of the most extreme members of Congress. Every day, hyperpartisan comments from him on Twitter every single day. Says a reckoning is coming for our gangster government. Folks, that's not how you talk before you become attorney general. That's how you talk before you storm the Capitol. It's never been the type of person we have had in the position of attorney general, of whom we get one. 435 members of Congress. You get a few extremists there, we can handle it. If we get an extremist in the role of attorney general, that would be a radical departure from anything we have ever seen before in this state. Voted against certifying the last election when he knew that was the wrong thing to do. Went around telling everybody that it was rigged when he knew better as an attorney that all of the judges and all of the courts had said the exact opposite. Said that his election was rigged even though he won. I don't know what was up with that. That's weird behavior. And to say that a reckoning is coming for our gangster government is exactly the type of inflammatory language that actually leads to violence. It is the exact opposite temperament and tone that we have ever had and that we should rightfully expect from our top law enforcement officer.
Congressman Bishop, 2 minutes.
You will not resolve the problem of fentanyl in North Carolina by a money laundering statute, that's not the problem. The problem in North Carolina, if you ask a law enforcement officer or DA in North Carolina, is an unsecured border where fentanyl pours over the border. And the way to fix that is not tinkering with this statute or that statute in North Carolina. It is to secure the border. But Jeff Jackson has voted with the most extreme leftists in Congress against every measure to secure the border that we have proposed. But that is not all. You talk about, Mr. Jackson speaks about temperament and tone, but the most important issue is, remember the motto of North Carolina, to be rather than to seem. He may seem to be moderate, but his record is radically leftist. In Congress this year, I don't often brag about agreeing with Joe Biden and Chuck Schumer, but in Congress this year, or last year, we voted in H.J. Res 26 to reverse the D.C. Council's radical rewrite of their criminal code, in which they cut sentences across the board in these days and eliminated mandatory minimums. Chuck Schumer voted, his Senate voted to reverse that. Joe Biden signed it. Jeff Jackson voted with Nancy Pelosi, AOC, and Bernie Sanders. That's what he's done. And if you look at his record, he voted against the Secure the Border Act. He voted against Protection of Women and Girls in Sports Act. He voted as a legislature against the anti-rioting bill, against the anti-criminal gang bill, against the anti-graffiti vandalism bill, against requiring sheriffs to cooperate with ICE, on and on and on. He has persistently maintained a soft on crime position in legislative vote after legislative vote after legislative vote, and he has been antagonistic and anti-police. Our law enforcement system in North Carolina cannot survive that kind of policy. And yes, I will see to it that we enforce the law and that we work carefully and completely. And you'll see prosecutors and sheriffs in great number across this state who have experienced this exact sort of policy. They know a change is needed. You'll wait to hear from them.
Our next question. This week, the Surgeon General called for health warnings on social media apps, much like tobacco label warnings. This follows the news of potential TikTok ban in the U.S. Where are you most concerned when it comes to social media, and how would you tackle this topic as Attorney General? Congressman Bishop, your 2 minutes.
Repeat that. How would say that again, please?
How would you tackle the issue of social media, potentially the companies as Attorney General, in light of the Surgeon General warning and also the potential ban on TikTok?
It's very interesting. Social media is an interesting phenomenon. I don't love it. I think a lot of it is invites some of the worst conduct in our civil discourse. One thing that is interesting, though, is how you decide what decisions you make on that for Americans should be for Americans to make. And here is, by the way, another really important aspect of what the Attorney General's responsibility is, and that is to protect fundamental rights of North Carolinians. Jeff has developed a massive following on social media. He's done it assiduously. He spent $1 million in his United States Senate campaign in 2022 building lists, acquiring digital lists, and he's worked at it assiduously, particularly on TikTok, where he has over 2 million followers, whatever that signifies. But this year in Congress, the Congress voted, and here's something, I do depart from my party whenever circumstances require it. In the United States Congress, they passed a law this year to ban TikTok. Jeff, having assiduously cultivated a following on there and used it for his political purposes, voted to ban it. I've never used TikTok, but I value the First Amendment right of Americans to speak. The United States Supreme Court spoke to this in 1965 and said, Americans, this may surprise you, but look it up, Lamont versus Postmaster General, Americans have a First Amendment right of access to foreign propaganda. So if this TikTok is operated by the Chinese government or Chinese government has influence with the owners of it, then the answer to that is don't use it. But I do respect the fact that 170 million Americans have made a different choice, including Jeff Jackson, and he went and voted to ban it after having used it for his advantage. That is the polar opposite of commitment to fundamental rights or making your decisions predicated upon the law. And one other issue I'll just mention as long as we're there is that the United States Congress in that bill said TikTok's only recourse is to go to the Court of Appeals of the District of for DC, not even a trial court, and start there in original jurisdiction and then they get one shot to go to the United States Supreme Court.
Congressman, your time's up. Congressman Jackson, 2 minutes.
I'm going to answer the question, and then we'll talk about TikTok. The question was about the potential harms that social media pose, particularly to young people. I have a 15-year-old at home. I'm well acquainted with this, and there is every reason to be concerned. It was very clear that around 2012, self-harm among teenagers started to skyrocket, particularly among young women. There's a real problem here. There are cases pending right now that allege that social media companies have engineered these social media apps to function basically as dopamine hamster wheels, basically slot machines that serve basically the same function, just in a different way. Of course, that's a major concern. There's an upside to social media. You can use it to be transparent with people. That's great. People use it to connect. That's great. There's clearly a downside. We're running a huge experiment on all of our young people. And we have a bunch of social media companies that are optimized for clicks, optimized for content, optimized for money. I would be an attorney general who joined the effort to stand up to them. Our current attorney general has a lawsuit that he has joined along exactly the lines I just described. I would continue that work with respect to TikTok. He's right. I have the largest TikTok following of any elected official in the country. And I did that by once a week looking into a camera and saying, "Hi, you don't know me. I'm Jeff. I serve in Congress. And here's what I did that week." And as it turns out, there's huge demand for just being spoken to in a normal tone of voice. And people want to know what's going on in their government without the constant spin, the likes of which we're getting here today. But there is a major problem with TikTok. The fact that it is owned and potentially controlled by the Chinese government is an issue. The bill, which didn't ban it, not sure if you read it, Dan, said that TikTok can be owned by any country that isn't Russia, China, Venezuela, Iran, or North Korea. But it's fine to operate. But there's a major concern with having its ownership and potential operation by one of our main geopolitical rivals. I cast that vote knowing that I would take a huge political hit for it, because I also knew that it was the right thing to do.
All right, next question. A bill was passed earlier this month revising, raised the age to automatically send 16 and 17-year-olds who commit violent crimes to adult court unless prosecutors and the defense agree to keep them in juvenile court. It allows police to charge adults who entice teens to commit a crime as well. The governor has since vetoed. Where do you stand on this issue? We'll start with you, Congressman Jackson.
Well, I think the second part of the bill is a no-brainer. And if you didn't hear, it was making sure that if someone entices a teenager to commit a crime, that that in and of itself is a crime. I think just about all of us would agree with that. So if a gang entices a 16-year-old to go steal a car, it should be a crime to steal the car, but also a crime for the gang to entice that teenager. Like, the first part of the bill also points to a hole in the law. We sought to raise the age because we were the only state in the country that was still prosecuting 16-year-olds as adults. And so we fixed that. But there is a real problem. And the problem is this: if you're arrested as a 16-year-old, say you've been arrested five times prior for stealing five cars, and you're arrested for stealing your sixth car, you are not brought before a judge. You are going to be immediately released. That's a problem, because you're probably going to steal another car. And juvenile crime has risen. And a huge piece of that is car theft. I mean, if you factor out juvenile crime, the crime levels in North Carolina are actually in a pretty good place. Juvenile crime in particular has been a major problem. This is a big piece of it. We need to authorize judges to be able to see the criminal record first, to have juveniles brought before them, because right now that often is not happening. Then they need to be able to see their criminal record. And if we have a clear repeat offender, someone who is a threat to public safety, then the judge needs to be authorized to keep that person in secure custody. And by the way, you're not doing that teenager any favor by releasing him or her, knowing that it's likely that they're going to be involved in another crime and pick up another charge. So that's my answer.
Congressman Bishop.
It's not nearly that complicated. Jeff just said if a juvenile stolen five cars, he ought not be able to steal the sixth one and be released. I don't know. I think all this is more common sense than it is what he said. If he says partisanship, I don't think anybody should be stealing five cars and have no a consequence of significance. And what that bill did is, for the most serious felonies, it reversed raised the age. It said they're going to be presumptively bound over, rather than the district attorney having to go through the process of binding them over to trial. And characteristic to fashion, Roy Cooper vetoed it. I don't even know if Jeff said he's for the bill. Heard a long answer. That's a simple matter. That bill should have been signed by the governor. It will be, his veto will be overridden, I'm confident, and it will be part of what will be done. And Johnny Jennings, the chief of police in Charlotte, is no radical right winger. And he's told us, if you watch the events in Romare Bearden Park last New Year's Eve, if you watch the melee among juveniles last July 4th, if you're noting that the number of homicides in Mecklenburg County is up a third in the first quarter, and it's continuing to go up, and the most often or frequent participants are juveniles, that's got to stop. And law and order's the key. TikTok, and we can't be false about what we explain. Jeff just tried to say that the TikTok ban's not a ban. That is its instrumentality. It says it is banned unless sold. That's not that you have to own what you have done. I'm prepared to own what I've done. Jeff's attacked me because people rioted at the Capitol on January 6th. What I wrote to the public is what Judge Harvey Wilkinson, you know, radical Harvey Wilkinson on the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals said, let's understand the strategy that is being deployed here. Our country is now plagued with a proliferation of pre-election litigation that creates confusion and turmoil and threatens to undermine public confidence in the federal courts, state agencies, and elections themselves. That was a dissent. And that was exactly the set of circumstances that affected multiple states that were swing states.
All right, Congressman Bishop, your time's up. We're going to move on to another subject where I know we'll get agreement on immigration. It has become a huge topic, obviously, in the presidential race. What I'm curious about is specifically in North Carolina as Attorney General, what, if any, role should immigration play on a state level? Congressman Bishop, your 2 minutes.
Law enforcement in North Carolina always have in the past cooperated with federal immigration authorities seeking to control illegal immigration. And although federal administration of the security of our border has become disastrous to the results that some of which I was mentioning before, just here in North Carolina, for example, I didn't even get into the fact that they just admitted 8 Tajikistani persons on the terror watch list and said, once they were rearrested by the FBI in major cities all over the United States, the Secretary of Homeland Security's answer for why they did that is that they didn't have any derogatory information on them. I would think being on the terror watch list as Tajik affiliates of ISIS-K would be considered derogatory information. It's almost astonishing what we see. And yet, as I've already said, Jeff has opposed securing the border. He's opposed the legislation we passed over a year ago in the House to do that. He voted against that. But locally, the answer is also clear. Right now, there's a bill in the House of in the North Carolina legislature that will require sheriffs to cooperate with ICE. That should have been done years ago, but Jeff opposed it in 2022 when it came up. And he appears to oppose it today based on his comments. I would do that. And I do, as I said, one of the top roles of the Attorney General is to coordinate and focus law enforcement and to help them get their job done. And their job is to preserve order, to be in support of law enforcement authorities across the country's criminal justice infrastructure. That includes ICE seeking to enforce a border. Jeff's also been in favor of sanctuary city policy, refused to clamp down on that from the General Assembly consistently. And the chickens have come home to roost. It is not time to persist in the course of action that has led us to where we are. It is time to turn.
Congressman Jackson.
That's a lot of law and order talk from someone who said, quote, we must smash the FBI into a million pieces. That's who we're dealing with here. And I get that he has found some political attacks, but you need to understand who the actual extremist is on the stage. It matters that I score in the top 5% for most bipartisan members of Congress, and he scores in the bottom 5%. That's not anyone's opinion. That's objective. It matters that his first endorsements were Matt Gaetz and Warren Boebert, that's who he hangs out with in Congress. We've never had someone like that. Now let's talk about the border, because he talks tough on the border, don't buy it. We had a way to secure the border, which we should do, if for no other reason than we're a sovereign nation. Sovereign nations should have control over their border. There was a bipartisan proposal that wasn't perfect. We needed to work on it. But instead of working on it in the House, the far right, led exactly by folks like my opponent, decided to kill it. Why? They want the problem. They want the border to be a mess, precisely so that they can use it in the exact political attack we just saw, and watch the ads that he is going to run this fall. Of course, they're going to be about the border. You could write them right now. You know exactly what those ads will say. He can't afford to solve the border because he needs it for his campaign. I'm a strong advocate for reaching a sensible solution on the border, which, by the way, we've known how to do in Congress for years. It's really not that complicated. It's a logistics problem. There are ways to, plus up infrastructure and personnel, that 80% of us agree on. It's a huge point of consensus. It's folks like my opponent who value the problem more than the solution who keep getting in the way of us solving this problem.
This has briefly come up, but I want to dig just a little bit deeper. In recent times, the role of defending state government has come up more often as partisan politics ramp up and political bills are heading into the court system. Tell us how you would handle cases that you personally or professionally disagree with. And Congressman Jackson, we'll start with you.
It's a very good question, because the Attorney General serves not just as the top law enforcement officer, top prosecutor, but also the top legal advisor to the state. One of the core functions of the Attorney General is to represent in court all of the state agencies. I fully expect that that will involve representing a state agency and making a decision that I don't personally agree with. There's a 100% chance that that happens. And that's the job. You're duty bound to do that as Attorney General. There is an outer limit to it. And the outer limit is the state and the federal constitution, because you take an oath to both of those constitutions when you become Attorney General. So barring a clear violation of the Constitution, I would be duty bound to represent the state, even in matters in which I personally disagree.
Congressman Bishop.
That's not what he's told audiences all over North Carolina. He's told audiences that he disagrees with the General Assembly's moderate 12-week ban on abortion, for example.
I do.
And he's told them that he's going to fight that as the Attorney General. Anybody sitting in this room knows the current state of the constitutional law. It does not ban, it does not bar the General Assembly's statute. But he said he's going to oppose it. He is consistently opposed, like the last two attorneys general have consistently opposed, voter ID in North Carolina, something that 80% of in every poll indicates are supported, that has been passed in a constitutional amendment by the people of North Carolina. He opposes it. And he says he's going to continue to fight those things that he says are election of suppression in as the Attorney General of North Carolina. He's setting himself up as a legislative policy opposition point to the legislature. And that is unworkable, and it is wrong. By the way, something else we ought to address is he just said that the Attorney General is the state's top prosecutor. That's not correct. The prosecutors are the district attorneys around the state. The role in the criminal justice system that the Attorney General's office, other than informally and from bully pulpit and coordination supplies, is criminal appeals to the courts of appeal and the Supreme Court. Just never been in an appellate court in North Carolina. No appearance whatsoever. And not only that, but the Attorney General's office, if you look at, for example, their last year's report, it devotes 80% of its lawyer time to civil litigation. Most of the controversies that the Attorney General's office handles are civil. Jeff says his experience is superior as a prosecutor for 3 years handling misdemeanors, traffic cases, all on pleas, with the exception of one case that he tried, two cases, felony cases that
false.
I understand he tried.
False, Dan.
Well, he'll clear it up.
I'll clear it up now.
Right. Well, when you have your time, I know you're in favor of the rules.
Your time is up, sir. Sorry, I don't mean to cut you off.
I'll clear it up now.
You can use the next question to answer however you please. I'm not policing that. Let's talk about law enforcement for a couple questions, because this position is often commonly referred to as the top cop. So law enforcement agencies across the state have reported difficulty in recruiting and retaining officers. What do you believe the Attorney General's role is in that, and what do you think can help? Congressman Bishop, 2 minutes.
I've said it in answer to almost every question and in my opening statement. The most important role of the Attorney General is to focus, support, and coordinate the mission of law enforcement across the state. Jeff has said that the answer to the great difficulty in attracting persons to work in law enforcement is that they need to be paid better.
I agree with the fact that that is one of the factors. But it is true also that Jeff, in his entire career in the North Carolina Senate, voted against every pay increase for the Highway Patrol, the SBI, the ALE, correctional officers, every police agency that is funded by the state of North Carolina. He voted against every single pay increase. But pay is not the only issue. And if you don't believe me, talk to some sheriffs. Talk to some law enforcement chiefs. The other thing is the result of Jeff's advocacy, along with Democrats across the country, to say that we should defund the police. That began it all. And also the anti-policing. Jeff also, we tried in Congress to reverse the D.C. City Council's radical anti-policing law. Democrats voted with us to do that, too. Muriel Bowser had vetoed that bill in D.C. Jeff voted no, not to reverse it. Those acts, the rhetoric that he says he's the model of impartiality and reasonableness, and the laws that have been passed that are antagonistic to police have deterred police from being involved in policing. They can't recruit people. And until that changes, until we say with one voice again in a consensus, both major parties, that we all support law enforcement, that problem is going to get worse. It's still getting worse month after month after month in the D.C. Metro Police Department. They're still losing officers, and that's the reason.
Congressman Jackson?
Then let us say with one voice that we all support law enforcement, that they do deserve a raise, that well-funded law enforcement is essential. If you call 911 and you want a good response time, then funding law enforcement is essential. That if you want to have really good officers and if you want to keep them, that funding is essential. Everything we just heard from my opponent was said by the exact same person who said, quote, we must smash the FBI into a million pieces. That's not pro-law enforcement. That's not conservative. That's extremist politics that fits a pattern. With respect to my votes in the state Senate, very briefly, they're explained by the fact that those clauses were in the budgets, the annual budgets. And I did oppose the annual budget typically as a state senator because it always underfunded public education. And I know we haven't had a question about the way that public education intersects with criminal justice, but I think everybody watching at home knows that there is a direct intersection. I want to support law enforcement. One of the key roles of the Attorney General is to do that, is to make a case to the General Assembly for why well-funded law enforcement matters. For instance, we have 20 different state law enforcement agencies. 17 of them are paid in a variable way. Their pay is not standardized, so it's hard to recruit. In particular, for something like the DMV Theft Bureau, that is going to be one of the main ways that we cut down on car theft, which has surged, particularly here in Charlotte. We should standardize pay for all of those law enforcement officers. And that's the difference between someone who's trying to take a real, sensible approach to someone who's trying to cobble together as many talking points and culture war items as possible.
One more question about law enforcement, particularly since we're here in Charlotte where the tragic incident happened this year, 4 officers that were killed. Do you think we need to look at training and any policies regarding warrants of particular or equipment that officers use in those situations as well? Congressman Jackson, we'll start with you.
Yes, I think we're going to end up doing that. I know my opponent and I were both at the memorial service for one of those officers. I think what they're doing right now is finishing their investigation. They're going to provide a report and they're going to make some recommendations. I think it would be very appropriate for the next attorney general, who does have direct oversight, called something called the Standards and Training Commission, to help promulgate whatever recommendations come forward. But just as a broader point, because there have been a lot of narratives about law enforcement over the last few years, this terrible tragedy should serve as a huge reminder to all of us that law enforcement is necessary, that they put their lives on the line, and that sometimes they don't come home through no fault of their own. Those officers did not know that that day was going to be their last, but they knew that it might be. And of course, officers are always going to have scrutiny applied. They invite scrutiny. Talk to Chief Jennings. They know that because of their authority, it will always come with scrutiny. But it also needs to come with respect from all of us, from all of us.
Congressman Bishop.
Words are not sufficient. Acts are what matters. Attending one of the funerals of four heroes slain, among four who were slain, eight shot, all in one occasion. It is insufficient to show up and sit on a front row in a funeral to convey your support for police. The way you must do it is to vote for the increases in their pay, as I did, to vote for the anti-rioting bill, as I would have if I had been there, and the anti-criminal gang bill, and the anti-graffiti vandalism bill. That's the way you show support for law enforcement, and you engage with law enforcement. Do policies need to change as a result of that that event in which the United States Marshals Fugitive Task Force went out to take someone in? Yes. You know, one of the policies, we got to revisit bail and bond practices and pretrial detention, because the person who shot all those people down had been arrested and released multiple times after eluding police, fleeing from them, felon with a gun charges, and a host of other things on his arrest record for which he had never been held to account, absconding repeatedly. He should have been in jail. But the Attorney General, the incumbent Attorney General of North Carolina, sided with the ACLU in litigation against the Alamance County DA's office, or against the Alamance County judges, over their bond practices. And I've never seen a case handled worse. And other circuits in the country defeated that litigation using O'Shea abstention, but it wasn't even urged here. And that's happened. We have judges in the Mecklenburg County District Court all over North Carolina devoted to weakening bond practices across North Carolina. Those officers are dead. Probably some mistakes on the part. We'll see. Not going to prejudge that. But because of the policies that are letting dangerous criminals out on the streets.
All right, Congressman. Next question. Just this week, in fact, proposals remain to legalize marijuana in some form, whether medically or recreational. It's often focused on the drug itself, but in light of this audience as well, I'm curious, A, if you support any legalization, and second, the potential impact you think it could have with decriminalization. And Congressman Bishop, we start with you.
Oh, I don't, I'm going into an office in which, as Attorney General, this is another point, opportunity to reinforce this point. I'm not a policymaker. I do not have a strong position on the legalization of marijuana. I believe, as we look at the results that have obtained in states like Colorado, it appears to me to be unwise. I do not believe people should be incarcerated, nor need they be, or have their lives ruined by minor drug offenses. So that's about as far as it goes with me. I won't be setting that policy in North Carolina. It is a live debate. I'll respect the determination that is reached in the General Assembly, and I'll see to it that we act in coordination with law enforcement, the very difficult job they have. That's one other thing I guess I would say is, I was at an event not too long ago, and they were having a CLE for the North Carolina Association of District Attorneys and the Conference of District Attorneys, and their CLE was on drugged driving. So in many cases, drugged driving is displacing drunk driving, and the protocols have been developed over years to try to contend with that from a law enforcement perspective are sort of out the window. And it makes it more, I think we have to reflect on when we make that decision, or legislators should, the difficulty that it imposes on law enforcement all across the state. But as I say, I'm content to be the law enforcer and not the person who's making the policy in this role.
Congressman Jackson.
Glad that my opponent attended a conference on that matter. I was an actual prosecutor and dealt with that matter in a courtroom. Wouldn't, just as a caveat, let anyone at home get their hopes up too much about what this General Assembly might do on marijuana, in particular because of my experience there and the difficulty of getting even medical marijuana across the finish line. Despite pretty good bipartisan support, it still hasn't gotten across the finish line. They're trying again right now. This is really, I mean, if they won't even let cancer patients try to use cannabis to try and relieve pain, do I really think they're going to take the next step for broader decriminalization? I don't think that. But it is appropriate for the Attorney General to be an advocate for reform to the General Assembly, particularly with respect to the criminal justice system, entirely appropriate. The case that I would make to them about this is that roughly 24 states have transitioned from taking a criminal approach to a regulatory approach, and the sky has fallen in none of them. Instead, what we've seen, some states doing it better, some states doing it worse. My opponent makes a fair point with that. I'm all for learning from the mistakes of some of the early states that tried to do this. But the states that have done it particularly recently, they don't regret it. They're glad that they've been able to more optimally utilize resources within the judicial system and within the law enforcement community, as are law enforcement officers, glad to be used in a more efficient way targeted for more violent crimes. In North Carolina, we criminally charge thousands of people every year for possession of cannabis weighing less than 6 pennies in your hand. Is that the best use of law enforcement and judicial resources? As an attorney general, I would say no.
All right, let's stick with the somewhat similar topic. The current Attorney General Josh Stein has made opioid abuse a prominent part of his time in office. Fentanyl, obviously, a part of the discussion as well. What are your plans in terms of fighting the crisis that's impacting communities across the state as Attorney General? Congressman Jackson, we'll start with you. 2 minutes.
First, I want to make aggressive use of the new anti-money laundering law that goes into effect in December. We already spoke about that. Second, I'm going to ask the General Assembly for funds for a dedicated fentanyl control unit to allow us to more aggressively identify and break apart the distribution cells that exist within the state. That's focusing on the supply side. Now let's talk about the demand side, because the demand side is addiction, and we need an attorney general who can speak to this in a competent way. The people who are using fentanyl, they're not using it to get high. They haven't gotten high in years. They're using it to stave off withdrawal. So everybody knows who studied this, that the gold standard for treating those folks is something called medicated assisted treatment. The idea is you get them through their withdrawal so they don't relapse. We have about a third of our counties that are doing a very good job using medicated assisted treatment. I would want to push that out to as many counties as possible. Now let's talk about teenagers. A large percentage of people who are ODing in our state are teenagers. Lots of them don't even know that they're taking fentanyl. But fentanyl now is laced with everything. We need to send a clear message to young people. There is no such thing as safe experimentation with drugs. You are rolling the dice every single time. The DEA has an information awareness campaign that's designed to be tailored to different parts of the country. We're using it right now in Mecklenburg, and it's been effective. Chief Jennings has told us, we think this is working. I would be interested in partnering with more counties to get that information awareness campaign out. So big picture, focus on supply, focus on demand, focus on speaking directly to young people about the risks that they run.
All right, Congressman Bishop, your 2 minutes starts now.
I've already spoken to the main cause of this, which some want to shut their eyes to, but it is a wide open border and a flow of drugs across that border and precursors sent from China into Mexico, drugs made there and come in great volumes. And in many occasions, young people are dying not because they're addicted to drugs. They may be taking a Xanax or something like that, and it's a pill is laced with fentanyl. Those things are occurring increasingly. Fentanyl poisoning is the leading cause of death for those 18 to 24. That's got to stop. But you can't say I'm opposed to sheriffs cooperating with immigration and customs enforcement, and at the same time say you're going to reduce fentanyl. The national settlement that brought money into a lot of counties, that's great. Treatment is important. Drug courts are successful and important across the state. Those are policy decisions that the General Assembly are commended to the General Assembly, need to be supportive of them. But you can't expect to be wrong on the main issue of the supply and expect anything to work out for the best. And even as to the money laundering statute, Jeff sees he's going to use it. Well, that's again, Jeff doesn't understand the role of the Attorney General. He's not the frontline district attorney. They make prosecution decisions. Attorney generals never do that. Their department handles criminal appeals. But again, what you're seeing is if there's a stark difference between Jeff and I on policy, between Jeff and me, our difference in our experience is even more stark. And when Jeff said he's a prosecutor, I've never prosecuted anything, I thought, well, look into that. Here's what the state's computer system says. General trial court appearances of record during our careers. For me, 220. For Jeff, 4. Appearances in the business court by me, 24. Jeff, 0. Court of Appeals, 50-0. Supreme Court of North Carolina, 22-0. Appearances in the federal court system. For me in this district court, 60. Jeff, 1. Bankruptcy court, 20. Jeff, 1. Court of Appeals, 6-0. On total, 402 appearances to 6.
All right. Our next question. You have both been state lawmakers and members of Congress. You mentioned briefly about the other side of this, the legislature. How do you plan to work with the legislature and the judiciary in this role if you win, particularly if it's not your political party? Congressman Bishop, 2 minutes.
Well, it has been my political party for the past 14 years. I don't expect a dramatic change in that this year. In addition to my experience at the bar, which dwarfs Jeff's, and in fact, I don't even think it's fair to say he's had any significant experience in practicing law. He did, for those 3 years in Gaston County, serve as the complainant, according to court records, in 28 traffic cases, 43 misdemeanor pleas, and 2 felony pleas. And I understand from other sources that he tried one low-level drug felony case
Dan,
that led to
an appeal. Dan, you think that's how it works at the district attorney's office?
And don't, let me take my time, then you take yours. I understand I would be on the defense about this too, because this is stark as it can possibly be.
You're just misleading all these people.
Well, then you can tell what the answer is. But spending 3 years taking pleas in criminal court does not make you a practicing lawyer in a way that you can handle the complex work of the attorney general's office. I think I'll rest there. That we need someone in this important role who knows about the practice of law in all of its complexity and all of its aspects. And that's what I've done for 29 years as a litigator in North Carolina at all levels of the state and federal court system. And that is simply not the case on the part of my opponent.
Congressman Jackson.
I think we have some prosecutors in the room. I think you folks understand that that office means that you are getting in a tremendous amount of volume, that you are swamped with cases. That was my experience. I have no idea what computer record he is consulting. But honestly, spoken like someone who's never prosecuted a single case in their life. And the idea that we would treat our state's top prosecutor as an entry-level position, I mean, folks, come on. Someone who's never worked with law enforcement, someone who's never worked with victims. I've prosecuted major sex offense cases.
How many?
Domestic abuse.
How many felonies have you taken to a jury trial?
I have had over a dozen jury trials, and I've had several hundred bench trials, and you have had 0 ever. So take a step back. I've served in the military for now 21 years. I'm a major in the JAG Corps. Also served in private practice for several years after I was appointed to the state Senate, because you are not allowed to be a state senator and a prosecutor. So when I was appointed to the state Senate, I had to resign as a prosecutor. So had the opportunity to work in the private sector as well. So I have prosecutorial experience, private sector experience, as well as military law experience, as well as experience in Congress in not being a total extremist who alienates everybody. And I think that's really valuable as well. Look, you've seen a major difference here today. You've seen someone who's trying to engage with you in a substantive way on the issues. What should we do as the next attorney general? Well, we've got AI-enabled scammers that are coming up. What should we do with fentanyl? Well, we should address these supply and distribution cells operating within our state versus culture war talking points. We've never had someone who wanted to use the job of attorney general as an instrument of culture war before. It's very clear. I would like to use this job as it has historically been used. He would like to do something radically different.
All right, so that does it for hour one. I'm just kidding. Although I would enjoy that. Unfortunately, we are out of time, so let's continue with closing statements. Congressman Bishop, your 2 minutes starts right now.
I've never run from the fact that I am my time in politics, I've been very candid, blunt. I've certainly called things out that I believe need to be called out. You've watched, if to the extent you've ever followed my career, I have departed from my own party many times when I thought necessary, particularly in a Congress that is, I don't know who, how many people here or how many people may watch this, believe as I do, that the Congress is stagnant and in a status quo pattern and is failing to solve major problems that Americans need to be resolved. If that weren't so, then you wouldn't see 70 to 80% of Americans in every major poll say that we're off track. I don't believe in that situation that merit, that the best course of action is to continue to do the same thing in the same way and expect a different result. I think we've got to have a dynamic situation. We need to change. And in North Carolina, anyone who's watching can see that we're seeing challenges to our culture of order that are unprecedented. And you can see it most often, as I said, in the way border security is being handled and in how criminal justice is being handled. And that, of course, is showing up in cities, major cities all over the United States of America. I believe that law enforcement needs to function more effectively. I think the Attorney General needs to help law enforcement. If that's an extreme position, sticks and stones will break my bones. I'm not concerned about someone's terminology or their words instead of in lieu of their actions. Their actions and their substance are what matter. And that's why it's important that I be elected Attorney General of North Carolina. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Congressman Jackson, 2 minutes. As Attorney General, I want to focus on fentanyl. We're losing people every single day. I want to focus on scammers. I think they're about to become much more sophisticated. I bring a background as a prosecutor, as a legislator, as a husband, as a father of three. I think all of that would serve me very well. But there's something else I want to do with this position. I want to help us turn the page from one of the darkest chapters in American politics that any of us has ever seen. These days, people tend to equate politics with outrage. I want to be a small part of changing that. I want to do this job well. I think I can do this job at a very high level, but I want to do this job in a way that shows people they can have positive associations for political office, not just negative. Especially young people who are asking themselves, is public service worth it? Because all I see is anger. All I see is outrage. All I see is extremism. I want to do this job in a way that makes you safe, in a way that makes you proud, in a way that says, actually, public service can be about integrity and sensibility and at least some amount of decency and intelligence. There's no reason we can't have those things. There's no reason you shouldn't ask for those things. My opponent is interested in doing something very different. He is the classic political extremist. Anyone who voted against certifying the election when they knew better, who said that it was rigged when they knew better, who said his own election was rigged when he knew better, who said a reckoning is coming for our gangster government, who said our FBI should be smashed into a million pieces, whose first endorsements were Warren Boebert and Matt Gaetz, who scores in the bottom 5% for most extreme people. That's an extremist. And having one of 435 extremists is one thing. Having one of one as Attorney General would be an extraordinary danger to our state. Thank you very much.
Gentlemen, thank you for a spirited discussion today, ladies and gentlemen, the candidates for Attorney General of North Carolina.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
You've been watching a Spectrum.
There you have it, word for word from the candidates. I appreciate Spectrum's reporting on this issue, and stay tuned for future developments. I think that was a very spirited, they call it a forum, I call it a debate. That was definitely more of the more spirited debates that I have witnessed in recent memory in North Carolina. So again, please subscribe and become a paid supporter to AnnieDance.substack.com, my Cops in Congress newsletter, to help fund this important work as we move forward closer to the election. Thanks for watching and reading. See you next time.